Good morning. Welcome to Day 3, CISO Forum Canada, powered by EC Council, brought to you by CyberX on our CyberExchange platform. And we're at an interesting day today, being November the 11th at around 10:55 a.m. Eastern Standard Time. We will pay tributes to the fallen soldiers and veterans. Today's topic is developing a provincial ecosystem for cybersecurity initiatives across the province. You know, over the last couple of days, we've had some interesting speakers, we've had some interesting content, and we've been learning, sharing, and connecting. Ecosystems are an interesting thing because, you know, you look at the ocean. The ocean is the largest existing ecosystem on our planet, covering over 71% of the Earth's surface. It's a source of livelihood for over 3 billion people. And ecosystems are extremely complex. Within the ecosystem, you know, grade six science here, you have layers, and those layers are really defined by sunlight. You have your first layer, which really depends on the sun, the oxygen, etc. And as you go deeper within those layers, you get into complete darkness. And within those complex ecosystems, you have your food chain. To kick this right off, we are joined by Tyson Johnson, who is the Chief Executive Officer of CyberNB. Now, CyberNB was founded in 2016 to fill a crucial gap in Canada's cybersecurity ecosystem. The mission was to build an extensive national and international network of partners and collaborators in the business, government, and academia. A dynamic nonprofit, they are a connector and multiplier for the collective advancement of Canada's booming cybersecurity sector. Thank you, Tyson, for joining us. I'm going to start off right off the bat. What do we mean by a cyber ecosystem, Tyson?
So, Jordan, thank you for the invitation today, and great question. You know, the analogy you gave with the oceans is perfect. What we have found over the last number of years as CyberNB, and now with our SIPNet pan-Canadian membership, our magic or what we hope to bring to the table that we've seen some success with has been active collaboration. Ecosystems do not work well if there's no active interaction between the different members of an ecosystem. So what does that mean for us? So for our mandate, we actively engage industry, government, academia, and international partners, other not-for-profits, other non-governmental agencies. But by active collaboration, I mean we kind of actively collide these organizations together and do our best to try and identify where there can be synergies, how we can add value, and identify if one group's working on an initiative over here and this academic institution has resources that could benefit that, and there is a federal government funding stream that maybe hasn't been leveraged yet, how do we bring those worlds together? Through that active collaboration of members in an ecosystem, you can drive greater outcomes, greater value. So that's what we mean by kind of active ecosystem.
Okay. We're also joined by John Roberts. John is the Chief Privacy Officer and Archivist of Ontario. And since May 2020, he's been acting as a Chief Information Security Officer at the Ministry of Government and Consumer Services. He's been active in addressing privacy and record-keeping issues in data and digital initiatives throughout throughout Ontario, especially in the respect of data integration. Now, as a CISO, John is responsible for leading the delivery of comprehensive cyber risk management programs to predict, identify, and address threats to information security and enable the Ontario governments to meet its digital service delivery commitments securely. John, why is cybersecurity important to Canada?
Well, cybersecurity is important to Canada because Canadians want to do business safely. They Canadians value their privacy, which is put at risk if cybersecurity is compromised. Canadians want to get benefits from the networked economy. They want to get the value from innovative digital services. And if we don't have a robust cybersecurity ecosystem underpinning that, then quite frankly, as a country, we will fail to get advantage individually and collectively from the opportunities of a networked digital world. So I think it's it's fairly fundamental. And in doing that, that concept that you've seeded of a cybersecurity ecosystem is, I think, fairly fundamental in how we think about this. So cybersecurity can't be just about individual entities operating safely. It is about the networked economy in which we operate, the various roles of government, of business, of academia, of not-for-profits, all coming together to build that defense in depth, that literacy on behalf of consumers, that maturity for providers, and certainly for us in government. You mentioned food chains. We think a lot about the value chains that flow through from individuals receiving services that may be government funded, through regulators, through policymakers, the core data assets that we hold as the province, how all of those pieces fit together and the way in which risks can pass up and down those value chains. So looking forward to exploring that concept of ecosystems as we go through the next hour together.
Yeah, we're definitely peeling away at those onions today. We're also joined by Steve. Steve Onions is the Senior Sector Strategist, Defense and Security at Invest Ottawa. Steve is a dynamic, results-oriented, ex-military manager with many years of progressive experience in the aerospace and defense industry. Steve, can we achieve cybersecurity brilliance by simply throwing money at endpoint solutions, research, and startups?
Well, firstly, thank you for the opportunity to speak today on this important topic, as it becomes, you know, cybersecurity is a true horizontal within many aspects of our day-to-day life now. So, obviously money is a start. You know, nothing happens without appropriate funding. But I think we, especially now in the COVID era, you know, government budgets are being strained. So really it's about effective use of funding. The industry, well, the ecosystem should really now look at where we can get the best bang for our buck. Obviously, there's hundreds of millions of dollars available from, you know, federal funding, provincial funding, even private venture organizations. But it's the targeted approach that's going to pay off better in the long run. I think a good start would be, you know, what keeps CISOs awake at night. You know, what is the first thing on their mind when they wake up in the morning? So let's look at where the effective application of money could be. Let's not go down like the dot-com rabbit hole from 10, 15 years ago, where people were just throwing money around because you had a website sort of thing. Let's see where the best value for money is. The responsibility is with the ecosystem partners to identify those requirements and, you know, manage the public purse efficiently.
Good. And you mentioned, one of the things you mentioned is what keeps a CISO up at night. And, you know, a lot of times I ask this question to the CISOs that I deal with regularly. Yeah. And since, yeah, you know, we have John on here from the province. John, what keeps you up at night?
What keeps me up at night is really just recognizing how far we've still got to go and how fast the threat environment is evolving around us. So the fact that we are running fast to stand still is probably the macro level piece that keeps me awake at night. More granular than that, one of the things that keeps me awake is just the complexity of orchestration in this kind of ecosystem paradigm that we're talking about, where there are an awful lot of actors trying to do the right thing, operating on partial information, and I think the risk that we end up all striving for good cybersecurity, but actually competing with each other, whether that's competition for talent, whether it's regulatory competition that sets up confusing, inconsistent expectations and standards, whether it's dilution of efforts in the standard setting and the product development space. I think the getting the right balance where a genuine competitive dynamic will drive better practice, but avoiding that being corrosive or damaging. And I guess for me, in the province of Ontario, being charged with, how do we understand what the province's role is in a healthy ecosystem and really optimize that, lean into the opportunities that we uniquely have as the province, but without getting in the way of all the contributions that other actors need to make, so we don't intervene inappropriately in things like academic research or the real value that the industry brings to the mix. So just the sheer complexity that we are all grappling with, I think, is what keeps me awake at night. It will be different for folk who have slightly different mandates, but it's a really complex world which we're trying to understand, and it's changing all the time around us.
And Tyson, I mean, you're in an interesting role. 2016, CyberNB comes in to fill in that crucial gap in cybersecurity and the Canadian cybersecurity landscape. You know, in your years at CyberNB, looking at what other countries have done or other continents have done from an ecosystem setup that's worked really well, what are some of those characteristics that you've adapted within CyberNB?
It's a great question, and we're still early days in what we need to do in terms of whether it's any particular province or it's the country in general. But when you look out and you see countries like Israel, who, you know, certainly have certain catalysts that drive their mandate forward, but they are actively integrating and innovating across industry, government, and academia. They're doing it for a real threat that's presented to their country, obviously, but they are exporting that excellence around the world and are able to turn this into both, you know, the ability to drive digital resilience and resilience for their country, but also economic growth and economic advantage. And I think each province and overall this country needs to take a similar approach. You look at the USA, and for years they had a group called InQtel, which is an investment arm of its federal government, which goes out and identifies early stage new technologies in dual use areas that it can invest in and to then become, you know, US sovereign technologies and then help those companies mature. In this country, we neither have an InQtel investment arm, nor do we have the kind of sense of urgency around, active collaboration that we need to. What we're trying to bring from our side is that active coordination between these groups and try and drive that message. You know, here we are on November 11th, and I have to say, I had the, you know, honor to serve my country in peacetime in the intelligence world, but I lived through 9/11, and I can tell you that if you remember the executive summary of the 9/11 Commission report, one of the phrases that sticks is that we had a collective lack of imagination, a collective lack of ability to share information, collaborate, coordinate, work for a greater good, to what John talks about, kind of coordinating and finding ways to work together. There has to be a sense of urgency around that across both of those areas, so that we can step up the way that Israel and the US and others have done so.
Yeah. And, you know, it's interesting, Tyson, that you bring that up. The wars were fought on land with ships, and ammunition. Mm-hmm. It's a different type of war we're in now, with national threat actors and nationwide, you know, issues that are happening. We're at a unique time where the world has gone digital. You now have a 3-year-old able to use Zoom, and you have a 90-year-old that's able to use Zoom. No one would have ever thought that that is possible. And with, you know, the recent announcements from our Prime Minister, getting, you know, to have Canada connected over the next 2 years, access to the internet, and then you have the great Elon Musk doing his thing. We're at a very interesting time as a nation. And going back to that ocean ecosystem, the three layers within that ecosystem, they rely on sunlight, they rely on oxygen, they rely on the nutrients in the water, they rely on how near they are to the land. But most importantly, within that ecosystem is the marine ecosystem. And those are your coral reefs. And these are the places that house and protect some of the important nutrients. And I want to take this conversation towards the talent pool. And really, one of the things that Israel does very, very well is educating their youth, right? And I'm not talking, you know, right now I don't want to talk about, you know, between 5 and 11 or 5 and 12. I really want to get into, you know, in Canada here we have, you know, high school, right? You know, the ages between, you know, 15, 16, all the way to about 19, where the most impressionable, especially when it comes to cyber. So, Steve, I wanted to, you know, take this over to you with regards to the talent pool. What is Invest Ottawa doing with regards to, you know, the talent pool within Ottawa and within across Canada as well?
Yeah. So, yeah, great question again. Just following up on something Tyson brought up. I think the Israeli model is slightly different because Israel is more of a militaristic society, if you like, through necessity. And a lot of their advancements in cyber is driven by the requirements of the Israeli Defense Force. A lot of their senior cyber executives come from there. So I don't know whether it's a good or a bad thing that Canada is slightly less militaristic, if you like, than other countries. But that definitely is a driver. Like the influx of talent from military into the commercial cyber world is something that we really need to tap into more. There's a few programs, Coding for Vets, run out of Toronto, and one of our local colleges, Willis College, which is a private college. They work with the Canadian government to provide opportunities for veterans moving into the coding world. But in a general sense, so Invest Ottawa, we were fortunate enough to be funded by the City of Ottawa to set up our own talent attraction scheme. So we're working with companies in the high-tech sector to provide support to them. We have over 5,000 pre-screened candidates in our database ready to be deployed wherever the need is. So that's where we're helping grow local talent. But we also look at bringing in one of our mandates is foreign direct investment. In other words, attracting companies from overseas to establish in the national capital region. So we work with those companies providing support in talent, and also one of the main gateways, if you like, into Canada is through the global talent scheme under the Global Skills Strategy. Sorry, I have to get my acronyms the right way around there. So for specific job categories and levels, Immigration Canada runs an expedited process where their goal is, I think, 80% of applications processed within 10 business days. And that really is an excellent way for these companies to bring senior executives in, get them established here, and then look to the local talent pool to fill the bench, if you like. And Invest Ottawa is actually a referral partner for the Global Talent Scheme. So we can work with companies who want to establish here, and we can help get their cases reviewed and promote their company to Immigration Canada as a valid entity and really bringing a benefit to the local ecosystem.
Yeah, well, I mean, Stephen, you brought up right now an important point, and that is Israel is from a military standpoint, it's one of those things you have to do, right? But one of the things that we can take and some of the attributes that we can take of what the Israel military does is it indoctrines it within the school system. You know, I'm born and raised here. My parents came here in the 70s. I went through the Scarborough Board of Education or the Canadian school system. Nowhere along the way was I ever taught about cybersecurity. Now, I understand that was, you know, eons ago. And for all of us, it was probably ages ago. However, even if you look at it right now, my children do attend school. It's not discussed, right? And I think, you know, just the way other courses are discussed, like social studies and geography, there should be importance towards cybersecurity, and it should really come down from the federal government, which then brings it into the provincial government, which then spreads it across municipalities with all the connectors. And Tyson, I just wanted to get your thoughts on this.
Absolutely. So couldn't agree more. So what we've done, starting in New Brunswick, and now we're trying to work across the country with different partners. We take what we call a K-20 approach to education. So what we've done is we've built everything from cyber immunization programs for, you know, kindergarten to grade six. And then that gets them, you know, aware of everything from digital citizenry to, you know, safe use of the internet, safe use of online tools. But then when we get into middle school and high school, this is when the traction really starts. And so what we've built are we built a few things. We built some curriculum that replaced existing curriculum in the grade 11 and 12 programs here in the province of New Brunswick, and then we're looking to export that to other parts of the country. And what that does is teaches the fundamentals in grade 11, and then grade 12 starts to get them more into, you know, white hat type hacking the approach to white hat, also into some of the key disciplines of what a career in cyber could look like. We have a virtual co-op mentorship program that's being run in the public education system here in this province, where we'll match industry up with grade 12 students that are actively pursuing, you know, these cyber courses so they can do work terms inside these organizations. We've even had, we now also support ICTC's Cyber Titan program, which is the Pan-Canadian competition for high school. And 2/3 to 80% of every team that registers nationally is from the province of New Brunswick. So we're actively promoting it. We have over 5,000 students in this province that are actively engaged in some type of cybersecurity training and education. We've even created something called the Cyber Defense League, which is, you know, the minor leagues of the Cyber Titan program, where students, it's the largest growing extracurricular activity here in this province, where students can get engaged in, you know, whether they're working on setting up a firewall or looking for malware or whatever it might be. They can do this as a competition that's run provincially. We're seeing students get offered positions by industry straight out of grade 12. And then this, the other piece that we're doing is we're working with, so we partner closely with US NIST and their NICE framework. So we believe in this kind of global skills and competencies framework that aligns with job roles. And then we work with industry partners to say, okay, what does your future need look like? And then we work with the colleges and universities and say, okay, here's the talent that needs to be created. Here's the types of outcomes these students of the future need to have so they can take the jobs that are in demand now. And working with everything from the 4-year traditional university programs to the 2-year college certificates to even the 6 to 8 month certificate programs with the private colleges like Willis that Steve mentioned. The pipeline of talent is in high demand, and we need to look at innovative ways of driving the awareness of what does industry need, what are the skills and competencies, and help those programs build and be more dynamic. And I think you're seeing that really impact what's going on, especially in post-secondary. But we start early by saying, unless you know what the career path opportunity is coming out of high school, how do you even know what to take in university? So you have to get in that K-20 mindset. Yep. So that students know that there is a career path. Maybe they have some hands-on experience, some extracurricular activities, and then they can stream themselves into the right programs post-secondary.
Perhaps I can just add a little bit from an Ontario perspective on this, because a lot of what you're saying, Tyson, I think resonates with what is happening here. Ontario, particularly GTA, has been, I think, a little bit fortunate in that we have a combination of a lot of demand for talent from not just government, financial industry, health, etc., and we've got a lot of world-class universities kind of producing folk. But it's also really important that we don't just assume that the talent equation will fix itself. So similar dynamics to what you were talking about, early intervention in the curriculum, more on a sort of a cyber safety kind of individual, keep yourself aware of bad things that can happen. But then further through the curriculum into high school, starting to prompt people to think of cybersecurity as a potential career path. And then a lot of active work to give people a sense as they're going into university and college programs of what the reality might be, internships, the shadowing programs, co-ops, really trying to help people not just learn a technical education, but be workforce ready when they emerge. And rather than simply treating competitions as something where there will automatically be people there, treating those as also part of an education strategy where the competition for talent is itself kind of seeding the idea that this is a career worth pursuing and one that is genuinely available for people. Perhaps one additional dimension just to throw in around the talent and the education dimension. I think it's important that we also educate people not just to be technically proficient, but to be able to apply those skills in workplaces. Yeah. And I think if there's one thing I'd say we risk, it's creating people who are very good cybersecurity engineers, but are not necessarily bringing that kind of ecosystem mindset within an organizational context. They can speak the language of penetration testing and code vulnerabilities, but they can't speak the business language of why this matters to an organization that's needing to invest. So I think one part of that talent pipeline is not just people who are good at protecting us, but people who are good salesmen for the importance of the work that we all do.
Yes, I agree with that completely. Yeah, let's not overlook the soft skills that are required. Like, we've all probably been to seminars and conventions where after the fourth or fifth slide, the presenter's completely lost the audience because it's too technical, it's too death by PowerPoint. So yeah, let's not overlook those requirements of, it's important to be proficient in whatever domain of the cyber world you go into, but let's remember the soft skills that are needed to effectively communicate the message, distill requirements, and get people excited about it. We really have to, if you like, glamorize the cybersecurity profession. It's not nerds in hoodies in basements anymore. Let's push it out there as something that kids in school aspire to be a cybersecurity professional. I don't see that at the moment. There's work to be done there, and again, it's incumbent on the ecosystem partners to do this.
Well, you know, within the ecosystem, and I speak at universities and colleges, and even on my LinkedIn, I get several messages every week, and looking at the academia and the institutions out there, you really have a three tier. You have your 10% that come out with flying colors. They get their jobs at the IBMs, the AWSs, the Palo Altos, because those guys are waiting for them to come out of university and college. You then have your bottom half, which really are not going to get anywhere. It's just the reality of it. And then you have your 70% in the middle. They have the skill to a certain extent. They have the will. I mean, they've spent 3 years, 2 years, 4 years, whatever the case may be, getting that certification. The problem is the mentorship within that talent pool. And it really, I think, starts at the younger age. If we're able to fill in those gaps and provide those experiences, once they get to university and college and they've completed these certifications, there's more skill sets, there's more experience. Now, with COVID and with everything going digital, and I want to take this to you, John, from a collaboration, from a federal standpoint, now that we're pivoting, everyone's pivoting, how is the province pivoting when it comes to the talent pool or when it comes to any other initiatives within cybersecurity?
So there's an awful lot of collaboration work going on. I think for the province, the pivot that you mentioned is largely about seeing the economic development opportunities in the pandemic. So it is it's very much about ensuring we don't think of COVID-19 as something that we just kind of hunker down and wait out and then try to go back to normal. It's recognizing that this has had a catalytic effect on particularly online business, online services, I mean, government perhaps more profoundly than some other areas. You know, I think our Attorney General joked about there was more progress in the first 17 weeks of COVID than there was in the previous 17 years of attempting modernization. And we have certainly seen governments and a lot of organizations really embracing digital online connected technologies, which is a huge opportunity for us to recognize that it's not simply a matter of doing things differently. It's that we need to be doing them safely in order for those changes to take root and really be a foundation for the kind of economic development, the economic recovery that we're all hoping for in Canada. Right. And that happens when we are intentional and pivot and deliberately embrace the fact that we need to operate differently for many in the cybersecurity world. I think it's about accommodating the pace of development in this window of opportunity. You know, we are by nature, as you'd expect, cautious. And if you're doing security, you have to be a little bit careful, figure out the threats in a fairly robust and comprehensive way. And yet the cycles of business time at the moment are more rapid than ever. And that's a bit uncomfortable for a lot of us to figure out how do we ensure that we are taking a more iterative approach to security, which is being driven by this pivot to to embrace the catalytic effects of the pandemic. We will only get that ability to operate iteratively and at pace if we are better at doing the kind of active collaboration that Tyson was talking about before. If the projects are more actively sharing insights, if the workforce is more agile and can move talent around, if we're taking a more expansive view of who can do what, if the provinces and the federal government are dividing up work and not duplicating work across different jurisdictions. So it is, I think, highlighting that that collaborative complexity that I touched on earlier. And to their credit, I think industry, governments of all tiers are recognizing that, and the cyber community as a whole. I think when I saw we were talking about ecosystem, I was reminded of the fact that, you know, it's probably no coincidence that Tyson and I have been on, I think, three different panels over the last couple of months grappling with some of these pieces, because, you know, we are all collectively tackling that same dynamic about doing better cybersecurity at pace and in a joined up way. And to the industry's credit, I think we're trying to have those conversations collectively about where the priorities need to be.
Well, within the ecosystem, you know, just like a complex ecosystem of the ocean or the rainforest, there's so many moving pieces, both internal and external. You know, CyberX being an organization, we're a for-profit organization. We put on cybersecurity events. We're also an ATC for EC Council. We bring about innovative security awareness products. One of the challenges that I've seen over the last, 8 months since COVID has hit, and this is especially to the institutions out there, is immigration. Part of the cybersecurity initiative was relying on folks from around the world coming into the country, the talent pool, to help out with the existing talent pool. So Tyson, you know, now that this has happened and we're not relying as much on the immigrants that are coming in, the great immigrants that are coming in from all over the world, what is CyberNB doing, or what are you seeing that's happening within the provincial or federal initiatives?
It's a great question. And I think it speaks to kind of something that John and Steve touched on, which is, you know, how do we maximize the efficiency of what we already have? And so we took on CyberNB. We were awarded the ability to implement the Digital Skills for Youth initiative here in the province. And again, so one of our objectives is to continually identify what are all the programs that currently exist. And there are a number. And it's like, it's almost impossible, whether you're a private company that is either a provider of cybersecurity services or training, or you're a company who needs to become more cybersecurity literate and capable and maybe achieve a certain certification. Where do you even look to find, how do you know what the funding envelopes are? How do you know how to leverage, you know, my tax research credits to be able to leverage an applied researcher at a university so that you can improve your product and sell more in the market? How do I know that if I leverage Digital Skills for Youth opportunities for active internships through a not-for-profit that was awarded that, I can bring more staff on quicker and scale up faster? So I think the answer to the question is, we have to collectively know what's available in the ecosystem across federal government programs, provincial government programs, you know, these groups like MyTax that have incredible opportunities. Steve and his team have an entire suite of opportunities and options for companies. And then those companies need to have the resources and the take the time to reach out and also allow someone to reach out to them. So it's this coordination of all the resources we have today. You know, John's point of we've come farther in innovation in 6 months than we have in 60 years is because there's that compelling need. It's like the Israel comment earlier about there's a compelling need to innovate because they have enemies across all the different borders and they have to stay safe. We've heard stories of giant banks who have increased their ability for workers to work from home within 4 weeks. You know, yes, and they're also increasing their threat landscape at the same time. But this is the type of innovation, this is the type of new thinking that should never turn off when the vaccine is identified. And so let's figure out, let's all of us, whether you're a federal government person listening on the call, provincial government person listening on the call, or your industry or not-for-profit, if you have value to add, if you have a program that others need to hear about, you got to get the word out. You've got to start knocking on doors, because there's this incredible resources just sitting there that are not being maximized by companies. And so we can completely put wind in the sail of more talent, better talent, upskilling, et cetera, if we all get the word out, start really coordinating this.
Yeah, very good point. I mean, again, I'm going to bring this back to the ocean ecosystem. One of the things, the difference between a human or a man-made ecosystem versus an ecosystem that exists by, you know, Mother Nature, we call it for a moment here, the environment changes. What makes an ecosystem extremely complex and extremely amazing to look at is, you know, there's an oil spill that occurs in the Pacific Ocean. That ecosystem adapts. It dies as well, but it's able to filter through and it's able to really fight through. One of the things I've noticed, you know, being a Canadian in the cybersecurity field here at the ground level from, you know, across Canada, dealing with the private sector, the public sector, the nonprofits, the institutions, the certification bodies, I'm in a unique position where I get to see it from a different view, really, you know, 40,000 feet up and then 40,000 feet below water. And one of the things that I see, and this is out to you, Tyson and Steve and John as well, is really a federal mandate, a mandatory requirement for all of these ecosystems to A, identify themselves, B, figure out the connections within each of these, both from an economic standpoint, talent standpoint, and international standpoint. So just kind of taking it from there, and I'm just going to filter this into a question that I have here. How effective have we been in involving our Francophone and Indigenous communities in our work? I'm going to throw that out to Steve. Yeah, in Ottawa.
So we're here in Ottawa. We're fortunate that we're, you know, we border Quebec. So typically in economic development, we do compete with the Quebec government. There are distinct differences between the economic development programs in each province. But in cybersecurity, we do actually collaborate with our partners across in Gatineau, an organization called INSECM. Right. So INSECM. We work with those guys. We support each other's events. If we get a business development lead that is not a right fit for the Ottawa ecosystem, we're more than happy to flip it across the river to INSECM and vice versa. We support each other's events. We publicize each other's activities. So at that level, if you like, at the I would say at the municipal level, yes, we do collaborate. And also I'm fortunate to be engaged with Deb Clark Forster at MEDJCT at a provincial level. She's a fantastic resource and we lean on her heavily both to promote our events and our activities and also to feed into that next level of ecosystem. So I think the collaboration is there more on a working level than a mandated level. And absolutely, if there's somebody listening who wants to engage, you know, Invest Ottawa and any of the other economic development agencies, we're more than happy to lean in.
And Deborah is a very interesting person that you brought up right now. And just because, you know, I think we all know her. People that are listening have probably interacted her in some shape, way, or form, especially in the province of Ontario. She ends up being your connector in a unique way because she sits in the middle, which I call the marine ecosystem, and I call the provincial side the coral reef, right? Because you have the federal side, which is at top of that pyramid, and then you have the municipalities and cities and local organizations being at the bottom within this, you know, cycle of events here. And in the middle, you have the provinces right across Canada. And what Deborah brings is very interesting to formalize, you know, a Deborah in terms of having multiple Deborahs within the province that work at a municipal level and a federal level that are all connecting together would really help out a lot. Now, and John, I want to get your views on this, and that is with the academic programs that you see across Ontario and across Canada. Are we doing enough to grow the talent pool?
I think we are a little bit too complacent, to be honest, about the fact that it should be, if there are jobs, then they will be be people trained. But if I can just loop back a little bit, because I think your comments about Deb and her role as a connector are interesting. I think that one of the challenges I see is getting real connection between the economic development agenda within governments and the digital agenda. I think there's still a little bit too much of a gap between those, because on the digital government side, I think we are too prone to looking at industry simply as people that we go out and procure services and tools from, rather than actually being a real hub of innovation. So in terms of a healthy ecosystem, yes, I think we need to do more with the academic community, both as the educators of talent, but also understanding their role as innovation incubators. That is an area I think that Ontario has done a pretty good job with in terms of embracing the incubators in academia. But also understanding that while, yes, our commercial partners want to turn a buck, if I can perhaps strain the ocean ecosystem metaphor a little bit, it's not actually like swimming with the sharks. Actually, there's a really valuable contribution that our commercial partners want. And it's part of that kind of Brand Canada that we've all been touching on around a national tech ecosystem that really does embed security by design, that is based on world-class talent coming through. And when I speak to industry, I very much see people and companies who are actively looking for opportunities to contribute to a Cybersecure Canada and be part of a collective effort that says, this is something we Canada do very well. And I think there is an opportunity for us to embrace that role of industry as an active contributor to this ecosystem that we're all touching on, more deliberately, more strategically. And in a practical sense, I think that means being more comfortable in government sandboxing new technologies, finding the development opportunities to partner with emerging technologies rather than simply consuming mature technologies. But a real opportunity for us to get all of these different ducks lined up. It's, I know I'm sounding a bit like a stuck record on this kind of coordination piece, but the education, the research, the commercial, the digital, the economic development agendas, those all need to synchronize for us to really move forward as a nation.
Yeah, and you mentioned security by design, and Dr. Anne Kavoukian, the former Privacy Commissioner of Ontario, who I've had the honor of speaking to multiple times. You take a gem like that, Dr. Anne Kavoukian, who's created such a vast and enormous document. This is something we should be teaching our youth, especially in grade 9, grade 10. They should be understanding the high-level version of it to a point that, by the time they're entering university, they know it, they understand it. I want to take this over to you, Tyson, and that is with regards to the economic impact on cybersecurity within the local economies. Are you guys tracking this? Or is there some sort of information that you're gathering with respect to data on the impact with local economies when it comes to cybersecurity?
Yeah, absolutely. And just as a quick aside, Anne Kavoukian authored a book called Who Knows? Back in the Day When I Had Hair. That should actually probably be mandatory reading in high school classes, that will introduce people into how your data is collected and made available through your average everyday run of the bill like activity. So
it's so much more relevant now, right? With our kids now on every single social media device out there, which has a 20-page terms and condition that you click yes to. What are you giving your information to? So yeah, I mean, thank you for bringing that up. But yes, I'd love to hear your answer.
Yeah. So economic development, absolutely. So this is being tracked. We have, since 2016, a bit of a track record here in the province where we continue to look at it. What we know right now here in New Brunswick, and I'm sure it's the same elsewhere, but we're looking at an average annual salary, average annual salary across all jobs, junior to senior, of $80,000. In this part of the world, that leads the way in terms of average annual salary by sector. The secondary and tertiary spin-off dollars that are spent, whether it's buying houses or doing renovations or buying new cars or buying new houses, the spin-off economic benefits of a cybersecurity ecosystem cluster being built and thriving is significant, and it's unmatched right now by other sectors. You'd have to, and perhaps digital health or other areas like that would be similar. But to, I think Steve or John mentioned the kind of horizontal piece of cybersecurity. You know, whether it's digital health or it's smart grid or it's aerospace and defense, you know, AI, machine learning, whatever it might be that has cybersecurity embedded in it, it's a, I'm not going to say a recession-proof opportunity or investment strategy for a province or a municipality or a federal government. But I can tell you, in the digital economy, no one turning back the clock on how digital we are or how online we are. And so there continue to be economic benefits, but we have to double down on our activities, our investments, and our collaboration if we want to really compete. Because just so you know, we're not the only country in the world, province in the world, municipality in the world that is thinking this way. And so it's how quickly can we all row in the same direction and really become strong in this particular sector, if you will.
How do we do it? What's the smoking gun? What is it, Tyson, that you would like to, I mean, we have about 200 some odd people from across Canada and across the world on. What is the way that, you know, what are your steps?
Yeah, so I'd have two big asks. I mean, if I could say, what are the two big ones? One, I'd love to see a very active, integrated, collaborative federal strategy that works down across every province and every municipality as a coordinated engagement. That's number one. Number two, what we're seeing on workforce and skills, I would love to see public sector education actively engage industry more. Don't see them as the enemy. Don't see them as a separate silo. You have to engage industry. And I'll give you a quick example. In New Orleans, after Katrina, there was a case study done on public schooling, public high schools. They were destroyed inside New Orleans and they had no money to rebuild. So they had no choice but to engage industry. And they now have some of the finest high schools in the country that have technology capabilities, mentorship, industry engagement. They're producing some of the, you know, highest quality education systems now because they engaged industry. We are still refusing in the public system. We need to actually embrace industry alignment and things like digital skills.
John, you got any thoughts on that?
I would endorse the stuff that that Tyson's been talking about, the need for us to have a sort of a national connected collaborative approach to have some foundations based on education and development that is not purely about the academic stream, but recognizes there are all sorts of ways in which people learn a cyber literacy that starts at grade school. There's some specific technical training. There's all that amazing development people get on the job when they're actually in cyber employment, and that's actually part of the skills building that we have collectively. And I think understanding that while there's a comparatively easy to monitor economic benefit around the cyber industry itself, there's that bigger but harder to quantify piece just around building trust and confidence that enables us to nationally embrace that shift to digital that Tyson was talking about more rapidly and start to harness that the efficiencies of networked digital systems. You know, that's not directly and completely attributable to cyber, but if we have a population who remain worried about the protection of data online or whether their accounts will be hacked or however it is that you represent that, we will always have friction that is limiting the achievement of the full potential for technology to benefit Canada. So I think we've got to really embrace that value proposition story and start explaining at all levels why cybersecurity matters, why it's not just a hygiene piece, well, it's not just a compliance piece. It's part of the reason that I have a slight hesitation about your suggestion of a mandated approach, because I think this is more, at least as much a hearts and minds thing. I think if we try to use too much of a stick and a mandate approach, then we'll get kind of lip service compliance rather than the real investment in the opportunity that presents.
Yeah, and I totally and I it is a careful stick that we have to throw around. You know, we talk about Israel again, and that is something that was forced upon, right? As a nation, you need to protect yourself, In Canada, we haven't felt that need, I feel, until, you know, it's not about, you know, when, it's not about if, it's about when, right? We hear this statement all the time, you know, will it take a national disaster of some sort when it comes to cyber that we're going to go, wait a minute, we should fill those holes up. So Steve, you know, looking at it from, you know, from the nation's capital, what is it that the provincial government or the federal government can do that is not doing that could help help your mandate?
I think definitely some sort of coordinated approach. And I think also we need to potentially look at the different verticals. You know, cyber is horizontal, it cuts across many verticals, but let's look at, you know, where cyber is applicable to, you know, fintech, precision ag, drones, UAVs, autonomous vehicles, things like that. And let's look for the commonalities. You know, there's potentially bring in the public safety and military aspect. Obviously, there are certain aspects of military and intelligence cybersecurity that are never going to be in the public domain. And, you know, that's perfectly understandable. But there are, I think there are aspects of each of these vertical silos that can be exploited for the common good. I mean, the synergy between those intersection points of cybersecurity and the verticals are really the hot spots that we should be focusing on. So if there was some way, if you like, to do a pan industry review an inventory of where the innovation is happening in each of these verticals in cybersecurity, I think that would be a fantastic benefit to the ecosystem as a whole.
So we're about 4 minutes away, and I notice all you lovely gentlemen are wearing this red, beautiful poppy. And I just wanted to just take a quick round table around. Steve, why are you wearing a poppy?
Well, as a veteran of the UK Armed Forces, it's November 11th is a special day. And in different times, I would be at the National War Memorial remembering colleagues. It is an important day, and for currently serving members and veterans everywhere, thank you. Just be aware the nation recognizes your importance, and we thank you all for your service.
You and Tyson?
Yes, similar. My grandfather was a leading seaman in the Royal Canadian Navy back in the day. World War II, served with five brothers. They were lucky enough to all come out alive, and then they served at their legions and working with the poppy drives and laying wreaths for years and helping generations of young youth really understand what happened and why, you know, freedom is so important and the sacrifices of that. It helped drive me or motivate me to serve my country in peacetime in the Canadian government for a number of years. So I honor him today, and I obviously honor all veterans and those who serve and sacrifice for freedom.
John.
So we've been focused today very much on sort of looking forward, but I think it's also critical that we as a nation look backwards. And one of the other roles that I have the privilege of having in Ontario, as well as Chief Information Security Officer, is archivist for the province, and preserving and sharing the province's stories and memories so that we can learn and reflect on who we are and who we want to be going forward. And Remembrance Day is a critical part of that, of taking stock, acknowledging the sacrifices that people have made, that veterans have made, but the contributions also to making us the country we are, and the values reflected in those sacrifices that we'll carry forward and take us to be evolving into the country that we continue to want to be. So hugely important to also take these times to stop and reflect on the national experience and what it teaches us about what's really important in this country. So honored to be speaking today on Remembrance Day.
You know, one of the hardest things to do is really to talk about brave men and women. You know, we're standing here, I'm standing here live on November the 11th at about, you know, 4 minutes before the 11th hour of the 11th day of the 11th month. We're airing live from the town of Ajax. First of all, I want to thank Mayor Sean Collier and Don as well from the ECDEV team. And I'm standing actually in a church. It's called the St. Francis Church. It was built in 1871. And, you know, as you're, as I'm standing here, you think about, you know, during the different world wars, how many mothers or how many fathers and how many brothers and how many sisters have walked in here praying for the health and wealth of their family. You know, the history of the town of Ajax dates back to 1941 during World War II, when the largest defense industry in North America, DIL, was an ally in the war and providing supplies. Thousands of workers and their families in the immediate area, which is now Ajax, were involved. And one of the really cool things about the town of Ajax is the HMS Ajax. There was also the HMS Exeter and Achilles, which were commanded by Commodore Henry Harwood. And they engaged and routed the powerful German pocket battleship Graf Spee at the Battle of the River of Plate near the port in South America. And the name Ajax and the name of her sister ships became worldwide symbols of courage and determination. Ajax was chosen, therefore, as the name of this war-born community. And one of the cool things about the town of Ajax is they named their streets off of those that served on HMS Ajax. And as I was, you know, going through the internet last night, looking for and just really looking at different streets and names of people, I was just kind of skimming through and reading about their history. And I, after a moment, I paused and I just clicked on one. I said, this is the one I'm going to take for today. And that's James Henry Clements, who was born in 1910. He died December 13th, 1939. His rank was a Royal Marine Corporal. He served on the HMS Ajax. And James died at the age of 29 at the Battle of the River of Plate. He and other Royal Marines were stationed in the X and Y turrets. Some were responsible for loading and firing the guns in the turrets, and others were stationed in the ammunition storage areas in the bowels of the ship. Now, these Marines were responsible for loading these 6-foot shells onto the hydraulic hoist, which raised them to the gun turrets, where they were loaded and fired. Unfortunately, one of the shell fired from the Graf Spee hit the Ajax in the area of the X and Y turrets. It entered through the commander's cabin down into the area where the Royal Marines were working and exploded. Many men were killed, and the X and Y turrets were put out of action. Corporal Clements was one of the Marines who lost his life. It's also sad to note that when James was killed, he was actually not scheduled to be working in that area. He had volunteered to take over a shift for a fellow crew member who was ill. To the brave men and women, to the fallen soldiers, to the veterans, and to their families, thank you.
Flanders fields, the poppies blow, between the crosses row on row that mark our place, and in the sky the larks, still bravely singing, fly, scarce heard amid the guns below. We are the dead. Short days ago we lived, felt dawn, saw sunset glow, loved and were loved, and now we lie in Flanders fields. Take up our quarrel with the foe. To you from failing hands we throw the torch. Be yours to hold it high. If ye break faith, with us who die. We shall not sleep, though poppies grow in Flanders fields.